Good morning. I'm gonna have to project. I'm not mic'd up to amplifier, and I have this thing to deal with. So I'm gonna yell a lot. It's okay. It's kind of funny that I don't know. Maybe it's ironic. Maybe it's serendipitous that the little warm up today, people didn't get into it. You know, and sometimes it's just because it's new, and you know, you don't want to feel something out, and you don't want to get up here and talk. But in the terms of the topic we're going to discuss today, it's just kind of apropos. We don't like thinking about that kind of stuff. So I'm going to back up a little bit and talk about the theme. Because at certain points in time, there are topics, events, situations, scenarios we're just not supposed to touch. We're not supposed to talk about. Things like interracial marriage, right? Or see if I can get this thing to work. Or equality. They're heavy topics. They're not easy to talk about. Or him. So why? Why don't we talk about these things? How do we get to the point, especially being in a country built on a pillar of freedom of speech, do we avoid things that are hard to discuss? Who decides that we can't talk about these things? What gets chosen to be listed as a taboo, as something that is just apart from what we associate with, what we discuss, what we try to solve? That's a lot of power. It's a lot of power to come out in a culture where we don't fear anything. I'm sitting in a room with creatives. You guys aren't supposed to fear anything. In fact, a taboo or a construct is your basis for creation a lot of times. I might even go so far to say that without any kind of rules or barriers or boundaries or processes, we don't even have the ability to decide what creative is or to recognize it. We need constructs. But in a form of taboo, it becomes a power struggle. And that power often gets perverted to be something harmful. Segregation. Or death. But everybody in this room has a secret weapon. You have a very powerful weapon. And it's the ability to look at something a little different. That's where art comes in. Art gives us the power to grapple with these taboos, with these big, overwhelming ideas or beliefs or rights or realizations. It also gives us a bit of distance, too. And that's where its power comes from. Not in terms of the artists themselves, but in terms of the audience. You can walk into a museum, see a piece of art, and decide to move on or let it move you. So what decides that? And why is that so powerful? The odd thing is, the bigger the barrier, the bigger the mystique or the taboo, the louder the art has to get. That's why you don't see a lot of great art about, you know, rudimentary things. Because it's just kind of there, you know? There's a Jack Donaghy on The Greatest Show on Earth, 30 Rock, has a quote that says, "There's only two great subjects for art. Ships and horses." And there's a lot of places making a lot of money, like, you know, Pier 1 or places like that where you get your art. It doesn't do anything for anybody, right? Doctor offices are filled with this kind of stuff. It doesn't move you. It's decoration. It's, you know, doesn't do much. But the power of art can cut through a lot of these things if it's harnessed correctly. Because a lot of times it doesn't have to be pretty. In fact, I'd say it shouldn't be pretty. if we are tackling these issues, if we hit them head on, we can be as raw or as ugly as the taboo that we're trying to face. But sometimes the situation dictates otherwise. In the terms of a topic we none of us like to discuss. Now, I wouldn't say that this topic is a human fear. I would say this is probably more of a cultural fear, an American fear. Okay, if you go overseas and through various cultures, if somebody passes away, the sentiment is it was their time. Here in America, if you pass away, the sentiment is you didn't try hard enough. What the hell's up with that? That sucks, right? Like, there's only two realities in life, death and taxes. Yet we have to deal with it. But it's super sensitive. It's super sensitive. So we decided we would tackle it. A little bit about myself. So I'm privileged to work at an agency, McKee Wallworking Company. We're an ad agency here in town. And one of our dear clients is a funeral home, French funeral and cremations. Like, who wants to advertise for that, right? That also sucks. But we have a very courageous client. We have a very caring client. And we have a staff to match. And so we can tackle these issues together to try to alleviate some of that barrier. So I'm just gonna be honest, part of my agenda for this talk is to help you fear a little less. And let me explain how that happens. 3 years ago, we pitched this idea to French to create a documentary. Okay, we realized that culturally, we do not like to talk about this topic. We keep it at arm's bay, and in fact, when we go through it, we do everything we can to not deal with it, and then until we have to. And once we do, everybody flees away, right? Think about it. A lot of family reunions occur at funerals. Why is that? 3 days later, everybody's gone, okay? Now you are left to deal with the grief, with the burden, and the fact that nobody wants to talk about it. How do you know if you're doing it right? How do you know when it ends? How do you know when it's healthy and when it's not? And so that's what we propose to French, is let's do a documentary. Let's let art try to cut through this, not in a controversial way. Every time we tackle a taboo, it doesn't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be Banksy-esque. It can be sensitive. Art is our tool, and we are the masters of how we decide to engage that. And so we thought, let's put together the best team we can put together to handle this situation in the most sensitive but the most honest way possible. We don't want to skirt around anything. We don't want to make this a feel-good session. We don't want to make it necessarily a sad, sorrowful one either. We want to let the grief and the process speak for itself. So enter the Grange family. Patrick Grange there in the background. Local family, really well connected to the soccer community, to their church community. They're just very well known. Some of you know them. Some of you played with Patrick Grange. He was huge in soccer. At the age of 27, he gets diagnosed with ALS. A disease you don't typically get diagnosed with until much later in life. Horrible disease. 27 years old. 18 months later, he's dead. It was really tragic. It hit the community. They had a little bit of time to deal with the reality of it, and then they had to deal with the reality of it. And so we approached the family and asked them, we told them what we were doing. That ultimately, we want to help everybody conquer this fear, or at least confront it. And they were so gracious. They opened up their house to us, they opened up their family to us, and they invited us in, all the camera crew, everybody. Anybody who's done any kind of production knows it's a production. And so when you have a crew sitting in a room with you and you're being asked these hard, difficult questions, it's hard to open up. It really is. But we were just so fortunate enough to have, everything was just perfect how it worked out. Doors were just being opened. There just seemed to be a guiding force with this whole project. And we started it 3 years ago, and it's just been this long process because we want to do it right. It's not about getting it done. Yes, we're an ad agency, and we have deadlines, and you know there's all of that built into it. But sometimes the project dictates the speed of completion. It just has to, right? And if we do it right, if we commit to do it right, then we have to make some sacrifices along the way too, and it becomes painful. So our agency, we've invested a lot of time and a lot of our own money into this. The production company we partnered with has done the same. In fact, the team we've assembled is an Oscar-nominated team. They've worked on films like Boyhood and Tim's Vermeer and a lot of Terrence Malick films. And so we had the people that knew how to get this done right. We just needed to let it unfold in its own time. And along the way, we ran out of money. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. Now, in filming any kind of documentary or going up against any kind of foe, like a taboo as big as death, you can anticipate a lot, but you can't plan everything. And in creating a documentary, you don't approach it with an answer, you approach it with a question. And a lot of times, the great documentaries, you don't answer that question. It leads to more questions. Because as a camera gets closer to the truth that you're trying to communicate, we realize that as people, we're messy and complicated and we have our issues all over the place. And that's wrapped up in the ultimate truth that we're trying to get at. So as we uncover one thing, something else pops up. And it happened again and again and again. One of them was the process of grief. What is the process? There's lots of books that go through the stages of it. And there's some truth to that. But what we discovered is that by claiming there's a process, then there's an also inherent lie that there's a right way to do it. And the more people we interviewed and put in front of the camera and started to peel back these layers, we realized that they're all over the board. So this documentary is occurring and being created 3 years after Patrick's death. So all the funerals have happened. A lot of the pain has, you would assume, it subsided. And time again, we found out that grief is a really large plane. And people are positioned all throughout that plane. Some are very healthily dealing with it in life and have moved on. Some of them are right close to the death itself, and it's raw and it's fresh. And some of them are all over the place, and it's not linear. So there was an observation that time doesn't really heal all wounds, right? So we created a social campaign to start a conversation and talk with people and engage them in how they deal with death. And part of it was bringing up these platitudes that we just, for whatever reason, have come to be part of our colloquial nature of dealing with death. When somebody passes away, these are the things we say. Why? Do they help? They don't. They never do. Right? Oftentimes they make it worse. It infuriates or it subsides. It diminishes the gravity of the situation. And so we tagged them all not helping, and conversation blew up online. People started to share their own stories. People started to ask questions. People started to push against these constructs that have just kind of popped up around us. Nobody had the purpose of trying to say, you know, we're going to use these phrases to deal with death. Here you go. Yet that's what's happened. One of the other realizations we had was that this is not a process, right? This is not a step-by-step basis. And oftentimes our own issues get wrapped up into how we grieve. Your biography often dictates how you're going to handle managing through grief or any kind of situation like this. And the typical response is we cover it up. We don't talk about it. And yet, as we filmed more and more and more, we have hours and hours of film and interviews. And I'll show a trailer here in a little bit of what we've pieced together, because at our stage in the documentary now, we've filmed pretty much 99% of it. It's in the can. The storyline has come out. There's one big question we are just looking to answer, or to see if it comes out in interview form, without forcing it, of course. And we're really hopeful. We're really encouraged to see how it all comes out. But the bigger story that we discovered is that we hit on something, on a formula that can expand and grow and scale. So the Grange family, they've made it part of their custom to get involved with Day of the Dead. Okay, so one of the pictures previously was an altar in their home made to Patrick during the Day of the Dead party that they hold on, I forget when the actual day is, November or something. What is that? First. And so, again, another thing just happened by coincidence to take place, in that we flew the whole production team down to Albuquerque during this time. They get into town, and at that time, Michelle Grange, the mother, tells us that they do a Day of the Dead party and they'd be happy to have us. We didn't plan it, but we showed up and we partook in everything that was happening. We got to see how a culture creates these ceremonies to help us deal with big issues. And the Day of the Dead, if you're not from here, is the weirdest thing you've ever seen, right? Because in a culture of we don't talk about death, and everybody's dressed up and painted like death, what the hell are you supposed to think? But the party played out in that it was celebratory. There was so much love there in not just recognizing the void that Patrick has caused, but recognizing his presence and how it's changed to be just a part of now. And that was really beautiful. It was really beautiful. So one thing that was just perfect beyond what we could imagine was in experiencing and walking alongside them through this grief in terms of the party. One of the deals of the party is you paint up. It's the sugar skull face. It's part of our culture. We see it everywhere. You see it in gift shops, all that kind of stuff. We have a tree ornament of one. Like, it's just, you know, it's become this trinket. But when you get close to the origination of why that is and how, where it came from a setting created to help us deal with these big issues. And it just perfectly set up this metaphor throughout the documentary that how do Americans deal with death? We don't. We cover it up. We put on our masks and we try to deal with it. And as the camera gets closer and closer to the heart of their grief, the masks start to come off. And so we filmed that, and they're getting raw and they're opening up and they're talking about these deep issues. And ultimately, that's what we hope will help people fear a little less. Can a documentary rid the fear of death? No, of course not. But if we can get people to talk about it, just talk about it, we start to chip away at that wall, that barrier that holds us against it, and ultimately help us fear a little less. So that's it, really. You know, taboos are a really hard subject to talk about, death being probably the most of it, but art is what can give us the ability to cut through that and hopefully help us live a little freer. Thank you.